Have you ever wondered why Chernobyl exploded? I will give you a little hint. Leningrad's reactor revealed the truth about RBMK years before the disaster on April 26, 1986. This time, we will focus on the RBMK reactor, its design and history, and we will try to introduce you to some of the most possible reasons behind the Chernobyl disaster. You will hear a lot about the other related matters which we have to include here, to give you a proper context. Over the last few weeks, we have published several videos regarding one particular subject, the history of Pripyat. It's tightly connected to the history of Chernobyl nuclear power plant, of course, so we took advantage of that fact and told you a lot about it too, but we feel it's time to refresh our content a little bit. Similarly, this miniseries will be divided into a few parts too, as it's a longer story. If you're interested not only in a quick answer to the question of how an RBMK reactor explodes, this miniseries is definitely for you. So, let's start with the first episode. RBMK Nuclear Reactor History, Part 1. How the Leningrad's reactor revealed the truth about RBMK design. First, we have to look back to September 29, 1966, when party leaders in Moscow gave a green light to the construction of the first reactor from a totally new generation. The design was impressive. Enormously big nuclear reactors, capable of producing power at the capacity not seen before in the USSR. This design name could be translated to high-power channel-type reactor. You probably know that it mostly goes by the name of RBMK, which is an acronym from its Russian full name, Reaktor Bolshoi Moshnosti Kanalny. Remember, at that time, the USSR and the US were the most powerful superpowers on Earth, competing with each other in almost every field: military, economy, technology, and multiple others. Even before the US first released an atomic bomb on the Japanese cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, Stalin, the leader of the USSR who was still alive at that time, decided his country can't rely on the current political connections. These could shift easily. After all, before Germany attacked the USSR in 1941, Stalin was actively supporting his later rival. And because of Germany's successes on many fronts, the Allied countries started to cooperate with the USSR, but everybody knew that this was an alliance born out of necessity, rather than a real friendship of nations. Stalin wasn't wrong. After defeating Germany, Winston Churchill, the English Prime Minister, ordered his chief of staffs to prepare a plan of attack. An attack on the USSR. Long before the war ended, Stalin also realized that the USSR couldn't rely on its military power. Later, this fear was fueled by the atomic bombs dropped on Japanese soil by the Americans. He understood that if faced with the destructive power of an atomic bomb, he didn't stand a chance and huge numbers of troops didn't matter. He quickly decided that the USSR have to get this technology too, as it was the only thing that would keep Americans and other Western countries away from his domain, which was more than the USSR itself. For example, his almost total dictatorship stretched over Warsaw Pact countries too. One of the outcomes of this decision, besides the USSR acquiring nuclear technology, was the creation of several divisions of specialists, scientists, soldiers, and spies. The first official bases for this kind of operation were the First Chief Directorate, the Third Chief Directorate, and the Central Board of Industrial Buildings. All of them had different tasks and supervisors, but overall, the goal was simple: make the USSR a nuclear superpower. They all evolved into a ministry which was covered by a thick fog of mysteries. It was the Ministry of Medium Machine Building, which was founded in 1953. Tell me this doesn't sound like something totally made up to cover some shady activities. If you said, sure, it sounds like that, you're right. After initial turmoils with the leadership over the new ministry, as happened a lot in the USSR, When four different ministers had control over it, finally Efim Slavsky took the job. He overseed this project for almost 30 years, from 1957 to 1986. If that second date rings a bell, you're right again. He was replaced in November, a few months after the Chernobyl disaster. The Ministry of Medium Machine Building was not only a think tank, but they also built the devices there, from reactors to bombs. They were also the ones who designed the infamous RBMK reactor, a reactor so huge it took around 1,000 cubical meters of space, 12 meters across and 7 meters high, composed of 1,700 tons of graphite blocks used as moderators, compiled into almost 2,500 separate columns. Its colossal cylinder was larger even than a huge house. Despite investing a huge effort in it, the design had flaws. The first RBMK unit was installed at the Leningrad station. It went online at the end of December 1973, almost a year and a half after the Chernobyl nuclear power plant construction started, and 2 years before the first reactor there was planned to start operating. It actually started in 1977. But even before the planned commission of the first reactor in Chernobyl, there was an important incident in Leningrad. After another maintenance period, Unit 1 in that power plant was being brought back online. And it was then that the reactor began acting weird. It didn't take long before it ran out of control. Same as in Chernobyl, Leningrad's reactor operators had emergency instructions, which involved using a scrum procedure known as the AZ5 button. But even though it was pushed by the power plant workers, the chain reaction didn't stop. And it should, as that was the point of the scrum procedure and AZ5 button. Because of that, a partial meltdown occurred. It wasn't anything pleasant, it damaged or destroyed a lot of fuel assemblies and released radiation into the atmosphere over the Gulf of Finland. This was the first accident of that scale which involved the RBMK reactor. Despite what you might think, the Ministry of Medium Machine Building did set up a commission to investigate this situation. The official report said one thing. The mentioned reactor had a manufacturing defect. But the truth was different. The commission knew very well that the accident was a result of another defect. The one in the design of the RBMK reactor itself. And the situation was specifically caused by an uncontrollable increase in the steam void coefficient, which is one of the most important processes going on inside an RBMK reactor. The findings were hidden and the authorities covered the truth, as well as the accident itself. And the operators that work with RBMK reactors in other facilities were not informed. That, guys, was one of the most important reasons behind the Chernobyl disaster. Thank you for watching. This was the first episode of our new miniseries. This time, we covered the RBMK design and its history. Be sure to watch other videos from our Chernobyl Stories playlist. That's it for today, guys. Take care, stay safe, and see you next week.